good. Okay, so I'm going to give you a lecture today on how to properly use UML for your project. But before I start, I have Yun Reed from the Enterprise Department who's going to discuss about the bright ideas which can be related to your final year project. Yun.
Excellent, thank you. Good morning, guys. Cool, like, you're not acting like it's Friday afternoon and you've had a hard week of lectures and stuff like that. It's only Monday. And is it your first lecture of the day, second lecture? Second. All right, for people that it's the second lecture, I let them off a little bit. For people that it's the first, that's terrible. So we're going to pretend that didn't happen, we're going to try again. Right, good morning, guys.
Good morning, boy.
Excellent, I heard from the back. Excellent, right. So, as I said, my name's Dwayne Reed, and I'm part of the Enterprise Department at the university. And what that basically means is I help students or graduates that have ideas that they want to turn into businesses, or they want to turn into projects, or maybe they're considering sort of like freelance careers. So anyone that's kind of like interested in, I guess, making money from the skills that they've got, they'll come. People will come to me and sort of like I'll help them out in sort of like various different ways. Because I guess one of the reasons why I sort of like help them is I run my own business. So as well as working at Kingston University, I run a childcare business that looks after probably about 110 kids after school. We got turnover of about 180,000, and we employ about 13 staff. So I always say to people, if you're kind of interested in starting a business or running like a freelance career, I can probably give you advice because I've kind of gone through those stages. Has anyone here kind of either run a business or ever thought that they might do something for themselves? Anyone at all? No. A couple of people on this side. So we've got business people maybe on this side. But I'm here particularly to kind of draw your attention really to something that we've got called the Bright Ideas Competition. So this yellow event that is highlighted here. So we've got something. I'm going to go back to that slide. Whoops, wrong slide. Technology is great when it works. The back button doesn't work on this. Awesome. Right, so Bright Ideas here. It's a competition open to all Kingston students that gives you the chance to win £1,000 by submitting a bright idea. Now, what's great, or I guess what's relevant to you guys, is at the moment you're working on, well, you should be, your dissertation, which is going to be, I think it's your dissertation 2,000 words. Or should be 2,000 words, or is it more? Is it 100,000 words? How much words? 18,000, 15,000, there's loads. Well, this competition, only the maximum sort of like words you're allowed in this competition is 1,000 words. And for most of your projects or your dissertation, you're gonna write much more. So I'm thinking to myself, if I was in the stage where I'm doing a project or a dissertation and I've got to write it anyway, why don't I just change some of that data and enter the Bright Ideas competition where I've got the chance to win £1,000. It's almost like getting paid to write an assignment. Imagine that. Imagine if for university you just got paid to write assignments. Like, I think we should flip around learning and make it like that. So for all of you that are, well, you're all doing sort of like your project for your dissertation, this is a great way to, I guess, earn a bit of extra credit. Another thing, another sort of like massive bonus to Bright Ideas is it's the kind of thing that I would say that employers are looking for from potential employees. Because just by entering, forget about winning, but just by entering the Bright Ideas competition, it's something that shows employers that you're the kind of person that is not afraid to come up with ideas firstly, but more importantly, put ideas forward, okay? Now, just to kind of give you a little bit more of an explanation of what the Bright Ideas is. What it asks really is it asks you to come up with a problem or identify a problem and then come up with a solution to that problem. And I'm assuming that most of you will be doing that in your final project, anyway, for your dissertation kind of thing. So it's not a business plan competition. A lot of people get a little bit confused and think, actually, it's a business plan competition, so I'm not going to bother entering. Yes, if you do have a business idea, you can enter Bright Ideas, but it's more about the problem-solution aspect of things. So what we want to actually say is Kingston University has thousands of students that have bright ideas or are able to do the simple problem-solution thing. There's only about 5 questions. I'm going to very quickly how simple it is. First thing you'd do is, like I've done here, is you'd go on a BizBoard. So bizboard.kingston.ac.uk. along the slider, one of the things is bright ideas. Or at the bottom, you've got bright ideas too. Once you click on bright ideas, it will give you the opportunity to, obviously, apply for the competition. It gives you a little bit more information. There's £1,000 prizes and there's £250 prizes. Eventually, each idea will be broken down into categories, but you don't really have to worry about that too much. We, like the judges, select kind of what category you go into. You'll click to apply, or if you're me, you've already got an application, so you'll log in. Obviously, if you guys, for the first time users, you'll go on this side and basically create an account. I've already got an application. So just to give you an idea of how simple, let's say, the application is for your opportunity to show that you're willing to put ideas forward or win £1,000. So the first bit just asks you for a public summary. So something that you wouldn't mind sharing if you were to win the competition. So if you've got an idea, that has a bit of intellectual property, you might want to share everything. So for example, this just gives you 20 words that you would be willing to share with the public, let's say. Inspiration, where's your idea came from? And then actually the bits that are marked. So an elevator pitch. So basically your idea in summary or in 100 words kind of thing. So that's the first part that's marked. The second part, like I said, the problem. So what problem or need have you identified? The third part, just explaining your product or service or your solution. Fourth part, alternative and competitors. So your idea might have something, there might be something similar already that deals with your idea. So we ask you to explain that here, because most ideas, they're not exactly unique. They might be unique in the way you're delivering it, but there's usually competitors to an idea. And the last part, so the last kind of question, asks you how would you get to your first customer or your first user? That's literally how simple the application form is. So five simple questions: elevator pitch, the need, the problem, the product service, alternatives and competitors, and sort of like who would be your first user. So very simple for like the potential to win £1,000, or show that you're somebody that doesn't mind putting ideas forward. And again, for you, this group especially, just use, you know, I would say, if you've got your own idea, great. Otherwise, just use your final project or dissertation idea and put it into a Bright Ideas application, okay? So I'm not gonna take up more of your time. I'm just gonna leave some, actually, any questions, any sort of questions, any general questions on Bright Ideas? So that's Bright Ideas in general. I don't want to take up too much more of your lecture time, but thank you very much. I'm going to leave some flyers if you are interested. And if you do sort of like have any enterprise idea or thoughts of running a business, on Thursday at the business school, we've got a fair that's got loads of exhibitors that will help students or graduates that are interested in business. So again, I'm going to leave flyers at the front. So if you're interested as you walk out, please do pick up some flyers. So thank you for listening, and good luck with your final projects and everything. And hopefully I'll see you around and develop your ideas with you. Thank you.
Thanks, Wayne.
Give it back to you. Thank you very much.
See ya.
Thanks, guys, and good luck.
Okay. So, let me somehow link what Wayne said, this concept of bright ideas, with your final year project. Plenty of the stuff that you can have seen in this form actually can come from your project proposal. So most of this should come from your project proposal. There are only one or two fields which support alternative solutions that ideally you should have already addressed in the proposal. And also, who could be your first client? Again, some of you have already addressed this in your proposal. So actually, it's not about producing any new text or writing something new, but possibly you could revisit your project proposals and see if you can get material to fill in this application. Can I help? Okay. So, let me find out a little bit about you. How many of you are doing design projects? Okay, 3, 4, 5 people. And how many of you are doing build projects? okay. And how many of you are using a waterfall approach for your software development? Waterfall? No one? Agile? What other software development methods are you using other than waterfall or agile? Okay, I can see that there are some people that they don't use any method. Okay. Interesting, a little bit risky though. So let me first, okay, so what I'm going to talk today is about how to correctly use UML in your project. So I'll first talk about why UML. Why UML might be needed in your project. So I think most of you have attended my lectures and workshops last year. Am I correct? How many of you have attended my UML module last year? Okay. Good. So possibly then you already know that UML provides some tools to visualize analysis and design, although UML is not the only solution to provide analysis and design artifacts. And the important thing is that analysis and design is expected in all projects. No matter whether your project is built or designed, you are expected to produce some analysis and some design in your reports. And actually, I have just copied the final year project report marking scheme from the module guide, which shows that you will get 10 to 20% for analysis, depending on the type of your project, and you'll get 20 to 30% for design, again, depending on what is your project type. So that means that definitely you have to write, I mean, the way that most students do it is that they have a chapter on analysis and a chapter on design, and many students, they find difficulties about how to populate those chapters. So far, so good? Any questions or comments? Okay? So then someone would say, okay, this is about writing the report. You have to write your report you have to submit your report in April. Why do we have now to talk about analysis and design? Okay, so let me check a couple of things with you. How many of you have done your literature review by now? Come on, don't be afraid. 2, 3, 4. How many of you have done a requirement analysis for your project? Okay, that is a little bit risky now. So from my own experience, I have been supervising final year projects for some years now, and a good recipe for failing your final year project or getting a low mark. When I say low mark, you know, something like D, you just pass the module. It's not ideal in your final year project to get a D, because actually you should aim for A and B. You should aim to get a first class degree or at least an upper second. So a good recipe to fail: you spend 2 to 3 months on analysis. And when I say spend, I mean spend, practically you waste your money, you do nothing. And then you spend another 2 months for design. And then in the last 2 months, you try to do all the important stuff, which is the implementation, the testing, and writing the report. This is definitely a recipe for failure. If you want to fail, or if you want to get just D for your project, follow this recipe, okay? How many of you want to fail? No one? Okay. How many of you want to get a good mark for your project? Everyone? I hope so. Everyone? Okay. So then, what should you do then if you want to get a good mark for your project? I mean, one thing is definitely you need to spend time. You should spend 5 to 7, 8 hours per week at least in order to, of independent time, on top of meeting your supervisor and coming to this lecture, in order to be able to progress satisfactorily in your project. But in terms of how your time, how you spend your time over the period of the project, ideally, you should produce some kind of implementation before Christmas. I know that there is this prototype presentation that you have to do before Christmas. And ideally, you should produce some kind of implementation to show to your supervisors that what you are doing is feasible, that you know the technologies involved in order to develop the system. You have already an idea about how this is produced and what is expected. Now, this is especially important for big projects, because for a big project, it is very important that you come with a final product at the end, and you will be just, your project will be assessed highly on the quality of the final product. But it is also important for the design projects that you go through the whole pipeline and you have an idea of how you can develop your prototypes, your final prototypes. So, if you want to produce an implementation by Christmas, that means that you have to do some kind of analysis and design before that. If you do a waterfall approach and you don't do it, in theory, you should finish analysis and design by then. But if you follow kind of an agile approach or something similar, then practically you have those iterations, 1 week, 2 weeks iterations. And within these iterations, you are expected to do some kind of analysis and design, especially in the beginning of the project. So what is very important in the beginning of your project is, first of all, to have done some basic requirement analysis. You should have identified what are your functional requirements of your project, so you know what is the system you want to develop. Now, this is something which is important both for build and design projects. You know what the project is about. You should have already contacted the client, if you have any client, or you should have somehow formulated the ideas what your project is about. If by now you don't have an idea about the functional requirements of your project, at least a first set of functional requirements, then something is not going well. You need to revisit that and say, okay, what am I doing here? Possibly I'm not doing anything at all. You have to come and say, okay, I want a project that does A, B, C, and D. And also, you are expected that you start producing some basic designs of the system that they can guide the implementation of your system. When we talk about design, how many of you have thought about the design of your project? Okay, few people, 4 or 5 people. But you shouldn't spend all the time from now till Christmas on analysis only and leave design after Christmas. This is, as I said before, a recipe for failure. So when I say design, how can we design a system? What kind of outcomes would you expect in a design, in the design phase of your project? So your projects, what kind of design artifacts do you expect out of your projects? This isn't a question for you. So, should I start asking people? Okay, tell me, what kind of design aspects do you see in your project?
Well, I mean, wireframes.
Wireframes.
Class diagrams. Class diagrams.
Class diagrams.
Sequence diagrams.
Sequence diagrams.
Activity
diagrams.
Database design.
Database design. Okay. So there are some stuff that tends to be quite common in most of the projects. So for instance, you may need to do some kind of database design. Many of you may have to design kind of a database, and you can capture that for a class diagram, or you produce an object-oriented system that again needs to have some kind of class diagram behind. Many of you are doing applications that they have graphical user interfaces. How many of you are building systems with graphical user interfaces? I don't believe it's only 1 or 2 people, okay? I'm asking this again. How many of you, do you know what is a graphical user interface? Let me ask this again. Do you understand what is a graphical user interface? If you don't, I will go to the module leader. I will say to fail you, all of you, OK? Okay. If you don't know what a graphical user interface is at the third year of your course, then there is something wrong here. Okay. So, how many of you you plan to have a graphical user interface in your systems? Half. What about the other half? What do you plan for your systems? I'm quite curious. Command line. How many of you plan to have a command line interface? No. Touchscreens? Touchscreen. Okay, I accept that. Audio interfaces? Speech recognition? Okay. So, wireframes then, many of you, even you don't know, you probably, you don't know that you need a graphical user interface, but you need it. Even the guy who has to do a touchscreen, still he has to come up with a graphical user interface, an appropriate one that is properly, it's inappropriate for a touchscreen application. So you need to come up with some kind of wireframes design. So we have wireframes, we have class diagrams for databases and object-oriented systems, and you need also some kind of process modeling that can be done either with activity diagrams or sequence diagrams. Any questions or comments? Now, do you think there is a value for me to keep talking? Or should we finish the, should we conclude the presentation now? You are tempted. Okay. Okay, so let me now talk, so I tried to convince you that you need to do some kind of analysis and design your problem. I'm trying to convince you that you have to start thinking about what is this analysis. Yanni, sorry, but you know, there is no other way to engage them other than walking up and down. Okay, so there is no other way to, so you have to do analysis and design, and you have to do this analysis and design, you have to start thinking your analysis and design now, not in April, not in March. Now it's the time you have to consider that. Unless you want to fail your problem. Okay? I'm trying to convince you that. And now there is some value for you to do, to consider UML as one of the ways to produce analysis and design for your projects. So what is UML then? UML practically is just a notation. It is a kind of a language that people that are involved in the software development community use to communicate between each other and also to produce artifacts that they can base their implementation later. UML is not a software development method. So UML by itself cannot tell you how to design a system, how to analyze a system, how to implement the system. You need to consider a more general framework, like for instance, extreme programming, agile, Prince 2, waterfall approach in order to develop your projects. But the good thing about UML is that it is independent on programming languages. It is inspired by object-oriented languages like C++, Java, and C#, but it can also be used with languages like Python and PHP that also object-oriented languages. It can also, some aspects of UML can also fit databases. And practically, there are 12 UML diagrams that can be used in three different views. So there are three different views that can be seen from UML. There is the use case view, the static view, and the dynamic view. And what I'm trying to do is to try and link these three different views with a different type of analysis and design you have to come up. Okay, how to use UML in a project? Question, how many of you create a project from scratch? So there is no existing code, and you just produce it from scratch. Okay, How many of you, you work on an existing system and you try to extend that system? Okay, so some of you have to do that. Now, why I'm asking this? There are two ways that UML can be used. So one way of using UML is to analyze and design a new system. And this is what we have mainly done last year in the database and UML modeling module. We consider that we have a brand new system to develop, and this is how we try to apply UML. But that's not the only way that UML can be used. So if, for instance, you have the problem of working with an existing system, then what you may want to consider is to use UML for reverse engineering. Now, reverse engineering, is this a term that you have heard before? Yes, any ideas? Do you have an idea what it is?
Yeah. It's taking codes and putting it into a diagram. For example, you may have a Java class, and you model it into a class diagram.
Correct. So the idea of reverse engineering is you have the final product, let's say a Java program, a Java class, and you want to go back, and from this final product, you want to produce a design of this system. Why is this useful? This is useful because the design of the existing product will give you an idea how to extend this product. So, two ways that UML can be used. Either analyze and design a new system, or if you have an existing system you want to use, try to do this concept of reverse engineering, produce class diagrams or sequence diagrams for the existing system in order to understand how you can extend this system and how to reduce them. Okay, so before I mention it, that there are three views. There is the use case view, there is the static view, and there is the dynamic view in UML. Now, how can this fit in your process? Practically, most of the projects need some diagrams for all these three views. What is a use case? Do you remember what is a use case? It is just a different name for functional requirements. That's correct. So actually, with the use case view, what you produce is you produce a view, a requirements view. You actually try to display how the requirements of the system are modeled, and practically the functional requirements. So the use case diagram is a diagram that is used in requirement analysis and represents goal level functional requirements. Now this is very useful. Now you're at the stage of the project, you should have set this goal level functional requirements. You should have an idea what your project, what the system you want to produce will be able to perform. The use case diagram is a nice way to summarize your system. So, with the use case diagram, now you can produce it. Let's say you can get out of this room, go back home, or go to a lab and try to produce a use case diagram that represents what your system is about. And that will provide you a good summary about your system. It will help you to focus on your project. It can also be useful, with client interaction. How many of you have clients in your projects, real clients? So you have few. Now, so this is the use case diagram, or an example of a use case diagram. How difficult do you think is the use case diagram? Do you need a PhD in computer science to understand a use case diagram? No. Do you need a master?
Maybe.
Actually, even your mom can possibly understand a use case diagram. What's the purpose for the use case diagram to be so simple? Actually, in some projects, your mom is your client, or your dad, or whoever. The reason for the use case diagram to be so simple is it allows interaction with your clients. You don't expect your clients to have a PhD or a master or even a degree in computer science. They can have any, I mean, as long as they can think rationally, then they can understand the diagram like this with a little bit of guidance. So useful in your interactions with your clients. Oops, no, wrong. The use case diagram itself may not be enough though for your analysis. You may have to produce some textual descriptions of your use cases. Now, this is something you have done in the past. Do you remember in which module?
Yeah.
Which one?
Database and UML.
Yes, I think you have done it also in the first year. Do you remember it? No? First year?
Business analysis,
that's correct. So in business analysis, you have done this use case description. Go back to your notes and see how these use cases descriptions look like. I mean, you have done it in my module, database and UML modeling, you have done it in the business analysis. Go and revisit your notes and see how this has been done. What are your questions and comments? Nothing? Everything understood? Are you happy? Are you happy?
Yes.
Yep. Are you happy?
Yes.
Yeah, that's a little bit better. Okay, I know it's mad, it's difficult to be happy, but let's make an effort. So actually, this project comes from one of my projects. Sorry, not my project, it was one of the projects I supervised a few years ago, which was about an application developing a system to detect faces on images and videos. And here you can see how the different functional requirements that will be provided to the user can be very nicely summarized into a single diagram. The diagram speaks for itself. I don't have to talk much about what the project is about. This diagram very nicely summarizes what is the scope of a project. Also, a use case diagram is a good opportunity to think about the users of your system. Are you going to have a single user? Are you going to have a second type of user, kind of administrator, or whatever user you may need to use your system? Also, the use case diagram is useful in terms of think about the wireframes, because different users will need different wireframes, different interfaces to access the system. And therefore, that can be useful for you to start building the GUI design of your system using wireframes by starting from the use case diagram. The use case diagram can tell you what are the things the user is expected to do and how many different users you may have. Okay, so someone mentioned before about class diagram that we have been taught last year as part of the database and UML modeling. Now, the class diagram can be used in mainly two different ways. One is to use for domain modeling, where we capture the names and attributes of different classes, different concepts, and the relationships between these classes. So that, for instance, means that what you want to do is to specify the real-life concepts, the real-life objects within your domain of your problem. Can you give me a few examples of your projects, please? So, does any of you produce some kind of e-commerce project, for instance? E-commerce? You are difficult, you know that. Come on, say a word. Project. Final year projects, am I in the right room?
Yes.
Final year students, okay? You know projects, you should have been doing a project, you know that? You have written a project proposal? Give me a title, give me some titles. Okay, I will come around. What is your project? Yes, please.
Can't say.
Why?
Copy.
No, it's not copy?
No.
Is it confidential?
To me.
No, it's not.
Land on application.
Who's that?
For recording statistical data.
But about?
Statistical data.
From games, statistical data about from games. Okay, what is your project?
I'm doing research.
You're doing research?
Yeah.
About?
Social media.
Social media, okay. What is your project?
I don't have a good project.
You can see some people escaping before asking them. Okay. What is your project? James Orwell, who is your supervisor? Okay. So, Kingston first, actually. I know Kingston first. I visited the headquarters, which is actually a company that tries to promote Kingston Center, the Kingston Shopping Center, and so on. So, for instance, they may want, what are the aspects that they want to model in their application? What is, let's say, what is this concept of, when they want to do this domain modeling? What are the important objects that maybe they may need captured? Shops, bus stops, or what?
Okay. So main focus on shops, restaurants, independent businesses, anyone's actually paying.
They may also want to consider about customers, different type of customers, and so on. So then, this class diagram, the domain modeling of the class diagram, will start producing an idea about what is the real objects that you need to deal with, and you need to produce some kind of modeling of these real objects in your system. So you have to consider a class diagram to produce the different type of shops and customers, or what other important things may be important in your own application. Okay, so this kind of domain modeling can be used for object-oriented systems, but even if you don't plan to use any object-oriented code for your system, this can still be useful for you, as this can be used for modeling your database. And also there is this class diagrams can be used for design modeling, where then you have to, the design modeling is useful if you really want to use an object-oriented language and you're going to base your all implementation on these classes of the design modeling. And you have then to represent those classes and their relationships. And these classes may be also conceptual classes, as in the previous case, but can be other classes as well. Any questions or comments? So this is, for instance, an example from one of the projects I supervised before, which tries to model, it's the design model of the system, where it tries both to identify the different classes, whether there are an inheritance occurring, and the different type of methods that they may need to be implemented. So the class diagram is the main diagram that can be used for the for a static view of your system. And so far, I have discussed about the use case view that can be used to represent your requirements, static views that can be used for example, modeling your database or the classes of your system. UML does not deal directly with graphical user interfaces, but there are things, for instance, coming from mainly from the use cases that can be taken into account in the graphical user interface design. However, in most projects, you have to consider also how the system will work. You have to produce a dynamic view of the system. You have to design the processes that will be happening in your project. Whether you are planning to have a build project that will be implemented using an object-oriented language or not, or even if you have a design project, even in a design project, you have to consider how the different processes will be occurring within your project. Even if it is just on the level of business analysis, you need to consider how the business processes will occur in the system. So an activity diagram is, for me, the most preferable choice for most final year projects. And this is most preferable because it is simple enough, so most of you, you should be able to do it with a little of effort and by just revisiting the notation aspects of the activity diagram. And it can be applied to both object-oriented systems, but also to non-object-oriented systems. The activity diagram can be used at the analysis step in order to visualize the scenarios of your use cases, but it can also be used in the design phase in order to describe various algorithms or processes related to your system. Practically, within the activity diagram, you can find those structures that are related to programming statements like if, else, while, and for, and also in the case that you may have some parallel programming occurring, then again, this can be modeled within the activity diagram. Just out of curiosity, is anyone considering using parallel programming? GPUs? CUDA? Okay, that's okay. So again, these are examples of activity diagrams that come from projects I supervised in the past, where they try to represent things that may occur in parallel or concurrently, and things, conditional behavior, and so on. So it was a way to summarize what kind of code is needed, and they were included in the design chapter. Dynamic modeling, process modeling, can also be represented with a sequence and collaboration diagram. Now, this can be a little bit more tricky. And I don't think any project requires a sequence or collaboration diagram. Actually, I have seen many final year projects that they produce a bad sequence and a bad collaboration diagram. So if you don't really know how to create a sequence diagram, don't do it. Okay? An activity diagram will probably be good enough. And I think that it shouldn't be too difficult to do it. You can just revisit the notation. It is, let's say, more or less straightforward. But the sequence diagram can be quite complex, quite difficult, and sometimes could be even unnecessary. So do a sequence or collaboration diagram if you are modeling an object-oriented system, or you have some kind of modeling or if you want to model interactions between different systems. So first of all, try to find a justification why you should use sequence diagram instead of an activity diagram, which means that you have different systems or objects interacting with each other. And secondly, if you want to use sequence diagram, be sure you know how to do it. Any questions or comments? Okay. Now, I'm going to talk a little bit about some diagrams that we have not talked much about those diagrams last year. I think Jarek mentioned them very quickly. However, those diagrams might be important and useful in a final year project to represent different aspects of the project. So one of them is the component diagram. The component diagram, I'm going to go through the points so I can easily. So a component diagram is a useful diagram to represent the architecture of a system. This is something that most students forget about, that you may focus too much on the functional requirements, you may focus on the class diagram, but what you may lack is an overall view of what's happening in your system. Okay, so I will ask this guy here in the front who says he has already gone through the design aspect. So what kind of application do you want to develop?
You mean my project, yeah?
Yes, please.
Minicab system?
Sorry?
Minicab system?
Minicab system, okay. Now, don't tell me details about the Minicab system, but I'm a little bit interested about what kind of technologies do you plan to use?
Well, it depends, because I've got web-based and mobile-based.
Okay, so first of all, you have a web-based and mobile-based interface.
Yep.
That's very interesting, and I will come back to this.
Okay.
Now, for the web-based application, what kind of technologies do you plan to use?
Ruby on Rails.
Ruby on Rails, okay. Are you going to use some kind of third-party elements?
Yes.
So Ruby on Rails is actually a framework where, yes.
Ruby.
What will it produce at the end? What do you expect as an outcome? I'm more or less Ruby on Rails as a framework produce the whole system. What about the mobile application?
It will be Android.
Android, okay. Now, who else should I ask? Who is looking at his mobile and does not pay attention on the lecture? What application do you plan to produce? What is your project about? Journey plan cap. And what kind of technologies do you plan to use?
It's an app platform. So using
what is
it? App for Apple.
App for Apple, okay. Sorry, what code?
Xcode,
okay.
To
develop it.
And Swift as well.
Okay. Do you plan to have some kind of database? Okay. That's probably a good example. What about, would you mind to say that what your project is about? This is project. No, not good enough. What is your project about? You're doing research, yes, I remember that. I have a guy that's writing on his laptop. What is your project about?
Mine is an Android app.
Android app, okay. So what kind of applications about?
The application is a password manager.
Password manager. Do you plan, for instance, to have a database as well?
Yeah.
What the database will be based on? The
it's an encrypted file. So
within the app.
Yeah.
Okay, let's take this example. That's a little bit better. Now, in many systems, in some systems, for instance, you may have a desktop application, all that you need is a single file, an executable file. Or it may be a single HTML file where everything is there. But this is hardly the case. In most of the case, what you produce comes as a collection of different files of different types. So you may have executable files, HTML files, you may have DLL, or jar, or lib files, or DB files, and so on. Can you recognize some of these extensions here?
Yep.
So what is a .exe file?
Executable.
What is .lib? It's a library, it's a static library file. So sometimes you have functions that can be sent between different programs, and you can compile them into a library and save it with this. What is DLL? DLL stands for Dynamic Loaded Libraries. if you run Windows, there are plenty of dynamic loading libraries in the system. Again, there are, it's code that can be sent between many different applications, and they are loaded when you have an executable running and ask for loading these particular DLL files. Jar? It's a zip, it's Java, actually. Okay. So you may have different type of files in your system, and you need Java to say, ah, these are going to be the files in my system, and this is how they will be related to each other. So this executable may depend on this DLL and so on. So you give an overall view of how the system would look like. And sometimes as well, you may want to use some third-party files. So for example, these DLL files, they normally come from third parties and you can use them. And you want to somehow show what is yours and what is provided by third parties. And again, this can provide you the option to represent the structure of the different files you use in your system. Now, component diagrams can be very useful in when you combine them with deployment diagrams. Now, I'm going to talk about what deployment diagrams are in a minute. Now, for instance, this guy here, he mentioned that his application will have both a web interface and a mobile interface. Anyone else with a similar plan to have both a web and a mobile app interface? Only? You're not very ambitious. Anyway, do you plan to have, where are you going to keep the data? Are you going to keep the data somewhere? The database, where are you going to keep the data?
Well, I mean,
in the mobile application?
No, because both of them would have the one database.
Their own databases. Okay. Anyway, but they're going to interact with each other.
Sorry?
The mobile app, the web app. So, in some projects, like the one that your colleague here plans to do, you may have to consider that your software will be deployed on more than one hardware system. So for instance, in his case, software will be deployed on a kind of a web server, but also in individual mobile, as mobile applications on individual mobile devices. And this is common in many kind of applications where you need some kind of network connection between different type of hardware. So for instance, in a client-server application, again, you have a similar approach. And what the deployment diagram gives you is the relationship between these hardware nodes between them. So let me give you an example here, again, coming from the project. So here, that came again from a project I supervised in the past, where the student considered a core server, a mobile client, and he had to produce actually code for both sides. And here you can see also the different parts of this application. So for instance, he had to produce some, he had to already use the Apache web server, the MySQL server that was installing the server, and actually he produced his code which was in this directory. And then he needed a mobile client with a Java virtual machine, and he used a taxi gps.jar. I mean, that project was a little bit old, where the people would produce their code in Java files. That was before Android, actually. What is the nice thing here? The nice thing here is that there is now an overall architecture about the system, which represents both what kind of hardware will be required, but also what kind of software, both in terms of third-party software, like for instance the Java virtual machine, but also the code that the student has to produce. And this is a view that most of the students miss, a kind of an overall view of how the system looks like. So this is actually a combination of deployment and component diagram. So the deployment diagrams about these cubes that they represent different kind of network nodes, the component diagrams about these items that they represent the software components of the system. Okay, what are the diagrams you may want to use in your system? So, there are other UML diagrams that they can be used only in special cases. So, for instance, there is a state machine diagram that can be used, for instance, to design an interface at different phases that an interface goes through. Anyone who produces a game or other kind of real-time applications. These statistics on games application, who was there? Do you remember who was the guy who wanted to produce a project about statistics on games? What is it going to be real-time?
It's not. It's for tabletop
games. Never mind. If it's not going to be real-time, never mind.
Define real-time.
Sorry?
Real time.
Ah, real time. Oh, that's interesting then.
In this context.
So then, for instance, for real time applications, you may want to consider diagrams like a state machine diagram, a timing diagram, in order to see to explicitly show how the real time aspect of your project will be managed. There is a package diagram that provides a kind of an overall view architecture of the system, but before you implement the system, but in the beginning of the system, and some other diagrams that they can provide more specialized types of dynamic views. Now, there is not much I'm about to finish, so here I have the take-home messages. Now, before I go to the take-home messages, how many of you plan to use something like a use case diagram in your project? Okay. Every project requires to do some kind of functional requirements analysis. And producing something like a use case diagram is the simplest way to summarize what your project is about to do. So, in different words, each of you has to consider producing a use case diagram. You may produce a first version now so you can guide your project and you know what you are doing. Talk with your client, but possibly another version later on when your functional requirements has been finalized. What about class diagram? How many of you plan to use class diagrams? Okay, guys, let's both raise both of our hands just to check if you are ready to do that. Can we all do that? Good. Great. Okay, now let me ask this. Which of you is going to use use case diagram for this project? Everybody has to use a use case diagram, okay? Class diagrams. How many of you are going to use databases? Most of you. Therefore, you need a class diagram or something equivalent. What can be a similar diagram to class diagram? Okay, if all that you want to do is database, then you can use that as an alternative. I don't mind. Okay. But if you want them to support an object-oriented system, then it may be better to use a class diagram. And all of you have to provide some kind of dynamic view, either activity diagram or sequence diagram, or both of them. So, requirement analysis. You have to do your requirement analysis. You have to do the requirement analysis as soon as possible if you have not done it. And a use case diagram is applicable on every design and build project. Choose the UML diagrams that are needed to design your project. But if you don't find any appropriate, then you may have to find what other alternative options are there. For instance, do you need a class diagram or do you need an ELD diagram, for instance? If you want to reuse, extend a system, use UML diagrams to reverse engineer the system, to see what's there, how can I model the existing Java code or whatever is already there. Every project needs some kind of process modeling. And for instance, you need to do some kind of activity diagram or sequence diagram, but you need some kind of such a diagram in order to produce the process modeling for the system. Definitely, object-oriented systems should have some kind of class diagrams, okay? If it's only databases, you can go away with the RD diagrams, but if you have an object-oriented system, definitely you need to have a class diagram. And if your system consists of multiple files, then you should produce kind of a component diagram to show how these multiple files are related to each other. Possibly this is not required now, but possibly much later when you have finished the implementation of your project and you want to present the structure of your system to the report of your final year project. And also, if your files are deployed on multiple nodes, so for instance, you may have to deploy a database on a server, some code into a Java application, again, you need to consider using a deployment diagram. Any questions? So, what will you do after you go out of this room?
Review.
Sorry?
My literature review.
Sorry, say again?
Literature review.
Literature review, okay. If you have not done literature review yet, then go away and do your literature review. What else do you have to do now? I'm hungry as well. Functional requirements. If you have not done functional requirements, you should do that as soon as possible. Okay, and then you have to move on to design. Okay, thanks for attending the lecture. Good luck with your projects.